Coming up on show 389, a bit of the Kia Soul, a bit of the Mercedes EQC, and a bit of the Audi e-tron. Those stories and many more coming up on today's EV News Daily. Well, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. In fact, wherever you are in the world, welcome to the show for Friday the 15th of February. I hope you had a lovely St. Valentine's Day yesterday. My name is Martyn Lee. I've been through every EV story that I can find today. A lot going on, but all of it, I think, some of it I don't want to report on because some of it is crazy rumours, which I'm not even going to talk about. You may have seen the stories about certain collaborations between certain different automakers, but they seem ridiculous to me, so I won't be reporting on those. These are the stories. I think this saves you time. I think this saves you hours and hours of searching the web. We distill it into the EV stories that you need to know about. Meanwhile, over at myev.com, they are working hard to make your life as easy as possible to buy and sell. It's a free marketplace, buying and selling EVs. Check out myev.com if you are in the USA. And congratulations today that we heard the news that myev.com and Inside EVs are joining forces to form the EV Network. It's going to be a digital platform that is an advocate for electric vehicles. So obviously you've got Inside EVs report on the news. You've got myev.com, which is all about buying and selling EVs, and I'm sure they'll add to that as well. Basically bringing a group of companies together, a group of organizations together, to advocate, to promote EV. Sounds like a damn good idea to me. We'll start with Kia and the Kia Soul EV. Styling that not everybody loves. Some people would say, only a design that a mother could love. Kia is diving headfirst into the world of EVs, and we now know how far the Soul EV can go. The EPA have given it an official EPA rating, 243 miles. This officially makes it the longest range EV that Kia's ever made, because the Niro EV misses out by 4 miles of range. That's 239 on the EPA scale. That's the American, by the way, the American way of measuring it. The Hyundai Kona bests all of them with 258 miles of range, though, according to Autoblog. What's inside the Kia Soul EV? Well, I don't think anybody thought that when they updated the Kia Soul EV, they were going to go for such a big battery. Boy, oh boy, are we glad they did. A 64 kilowatt hour battery pack provides enough juice for an electric motor, which kicks out 201 horsepower, 291 pound-feet of torque. DC fast charging is standard. Those Korean, the Hyundai Kia models all top out at around, because of 200 amps charging limit, about 73 point something theoretical maximum. They use this phrase when connected to a 100 kilowatt charger. And even very reputable EV websites have said, oh, they charge at 100 kilowatts. They don't. The theoretical maximum the pack can take, unless they've worked out ways of getting more current into the pack. But with the 200 amp limit, it's always going to be limited but to the low 70s, but that's still a good speed. DC fast charging is standard. You adjust the brake regen on the sole with flappy paddles. We like that. Anyone looking at an EV from Kia or Hyundai will make a choice. Really, the battery packs are the same, especially in the US, where only the long-range version of the Kona and the e-Niro are being sold. So it really comes down to body style. What do you want? You want the big SUV style? You want the crossover style? Or the Kia Soul style, which is somewhat unique? Because they won't lose or gain much on the powertrain. 243 miles is now official. More than sufficient, I would say, for any EV in the world right now. Especially if you can get the range on that quirky styling of the Soul. I think it's probably more popular with a younger audience as well. The Bolt EV sits so close in all of this. 238 miles of range on the Bolt. Nissan Leaf E Plus 3.0. The catchy name that is the new Leaf. On a 62 kilowatt hour battery pack. So smaller, and actually, if they were quoting usable range, they would be very, very close. Is only 226. How can 2 kilowatt hours make such a big difference? Kia Soul 243, Niro 239, Nissan Leaf 226. Well, it's because the battery pack size that is quoted by Kia, which is 64 kilowatt hour, is usable. The pack is actually, I think, in the low to mid 70s. they quote usable. Nissan have always quoted pack size. So when they say pack size 62, usable, I don't know. I've not seen any tests. Are they running on the roads now? I don't think so. But when it's finally tested, you'll probably find that it's maybe usable. I don't know. I'll pick a number from thin air and then be wrong. 55, say. That's why there is such a big discrepancy between the Leaf E plus 3.0 being 226 and the Kia Soul being 243. That's why. All to do with what they quote, and whereas Nissan tend to give you the maximum amount. Moving on to, let's do a run of stories on German EVs, because we've talked about Teslas a lot recently. The 2020 Mercedes-Benz EQC isn't in any driver's hands yet, but Mercedes say its new electric car is already sold out for the first year of production. On top of that, head of Mercedes-Benz cars Dieter Zetscher told a German newspaper there's doubt as to whether production could even meet demand next year in 2020. Well, Mercedes hasn't announced plans for the production figures for the model, says Roadshow by CNET. I'd add my own commentary on this in that I've seen two opposite reactions to this story today. Firstly, people are saying, hurrah, there's lots of demand for the EQC. They've sold all of them. Well done, Mercedes. And I've seen equally people saying, oh no, they're all sold out. Rubbish, they can't be making many, you know, more than 10 of them. And that's the thing. This is an interesting story, but really irrelevant until you know the numbers. If the EQC was going to be made 500,000 of them a year, and it won't, I'm exaggerating for effect. They absolutely will not have a production rate of 500,000. If it had a production rate of 500,000, and they were all sold out for next year, and they were all sold out for, well, this year and 2020, that would be a remarkable achievement. If this year's production rate is 5,000, if next year's is 8,000, then it's all of a sudden less impressive. But until you hear the number, you can't join the dots up. So all you can say is that Dieter Zetscher said this year sold out. At the minute, next year's looking sold out as well. Not a car that I could afford to put on my driveway, so I'm not personally that disappointed, but I am disappointed that we're talking about a car selling out before people have even got a chance to get excited about it. But let's wait and see. Let's keep our powder dry. Let's not form any opinions too quickly. Although we're still waiting for the exact range figures for the Mercedes-Benz EQC, the vehicle is set to debut in the US in 2020. The car packs two motors for all-wheel drive. Total output, 402 horsepower, 564 pound-feet of torque, an 80 kilowatt-hour battery pack. In the early test cars that have been out with the press, I've not been in one, by the way, but for the different members of the press that have been in one, the Roadshow's Stephen Ewing said the EQC had an indicated 228 miles of range left with 7% battery. That signals the car, even in its current state, before the super brains at Mercedes-Benz software have tinkered finally with the algorithms, it means it's getting very good range from that battery pack. The quote that I should give you then from Dieter Zetscher: we are sure that we will not be able to meet the demand in 2019 and probably not 2020, he told Die Welt. But we're doing everything we can to achieve maximum capacity. So again, bit of disappointment there that we don't get the chance to be excited about it because they're all sold out already. I think the pre-orders opened last year. But also, we don't know the capacity, so there's every chance that capacity could be increased. A bit of a story slash non-story, but I mean, it is a story, but it's one of those ones that I just sometimes just want to, I don't know, just press pause on a little bit, because everyone runs away with things and go, oh, it must mean this or it must mean that. Well, let's wait and see. It's interesting, right? Another story that, again, has different arguments being made about it at the moment. I've had people emailing me saying, you're not having a go at Electrify America, they're not doing their job well enough. Well, you know, I'm a few thousand miles away from the US for a start, but also I need to get my head around, what does it mean? Electrify America has 105 electric vehicle charging sites, 105 sites, 465 chargers now operational. And that, to my brain, seems good. Since installing its first ultra-fast DC chargers in May of last year, Electrify America has accelerated the pace of the installations. So, 105 charging sites we know, an additional 42 sites, that's going to house 189 chargers, which have been constructed, haven't yet been turned on by the utility companies. There are 85 more sites in construction, and 73 more sites with the permits approved. I think the beef seems to be the lack of the fast chargers. From the emails I get from listeners asking me to maybe be more critical of Electrify America, it's because they're rolling out the 50 kilowatt chargers. So of all the talk, of all the VW, you've been very naughty money, of all the talk about, hey, we're putting in 150s and 350 kilowatt chargers, the criticism seems to be there's too many of the cheaper, more convenient 50 kilowatt chargers, which doesn't really solve the future-proof problem of these fast charging cars. Again, I need to understand more about it before jumping to a conclusion. Let's talk about another German automaker now, this time VW's Audi. The Audi e-tron reservations have soared to 20,000. Now, this is a firm number. The German manufacturer said that the customer deliveries in Europe are now going to start not this month. It was meant to be last year, then January, then February. Now that's going to be March. It's another delay from the previous announced delay, which was then following the previous delay announcement. It's already been several months behind schedule now. The first e-trons, or e-trons, which means turd, by the way, in some languages, are expected in the second quarter, says Mark Kane for InsideEVs.com. It's all right. It's not the first car that will have been named with an unfortunate name. There's the off-roader, the 4x4, called the Pajero. It's got an interesting translation as well in some languages. Despite the delay, Audi has good news. Right. More than 20,000 reservations have been placed. I mean, it's global reservations, but 20,000, which is two times more than the official number was just a few months ago in September. The first deliveries to European customers will start in March. Probably. That's 20,000 customers worldwide having made a firm reservation. As of the end of January, in Germany, there's 1,000. I thought that would be more in their home country of Germany. 1,000 reservations for the e-tron, which, by all accounts, is a really lovely car. So, let's talk more about batteries a little bit. How big does a battery need to be? How big is the battery on your EV? If you are EV curious, are you thinking about, oh, well, do I need to worry about battery size? Or is it more about charging speed? Or is it more about how often the charges are? The e-tron, it is a car that uses just, according to an article today in Car and Driver, 81 kilowatt hours of its possible 95. They advertise it as a 95 kilowatt hour pack, but Car and Driver seem to have come up with, and I don't know how they've done this calculation, usable 81. Now, every automaker has a buffer. So even on my little Renault Zoe, by the way, I can charge that to 100% because it's not really 100%. The only one seems to be Tesla. 100% on a Tesla is 100% of the battery. It's why the advice for Tesla owners is always keep it between 20 at the lowest and 80 at the top, because the number's quite real. A lot of the other car makers don't give you the real number. They give you, 100%'s not 100%. You've got some headroom there, a buffer, if you like. What does the buffer do? Well, the buffer is there for longevity, and it protects the pack. And Audi seem to be quite conservative here. George Bauer at Inside EVs says that in one of the Bjorn Nyland videos recently where he was driving the e-tron, he calculated the amount of energy available as 82.5 kilowatt hours. Then again, he's in Norway, it's winter, the battery very cold. We don't know, as we don't have the battery temperatures displayed during his test, but the outside temperatures were below freezing in Celsius. On the other hand, we would assume that Audi would heat the battery. So maybe the battery temperature doesn't explain that. It seems like that's a big old buffer. This is a car, by the way, the e-tron. The Audi will charge at 150 kilowatts. That's the fastest out there. It's better than Tesla's at the moment until Supercharger's V3. So, is this big buffer, this big headroom on the e-tron, purely there to protect the battery because it can charge so quickly. We need more data to really put the story together. And a couple of stories then to finish off. First of all, let's talk about the Jaguar then. The Jaguar I-Pace. And how it hasn't impressed one analyst. Test driving the Jaguar's I-Pace showed it was a very credible first effort, but poorly executed, with the infotainment system and a dealership network that isn't best positioned to sell the car effectively, says a new analyst from JMP, Joseph Osher, said in a note to his clients. Now, I don't know his background, so let's not be too critical, but an analyst reminds me of the word consultant. You know, we've had consultants come into my work over many, many years. And some of them had distinguished careers, by the way, that means you want to listen to what they've got to say. And some of them, you think, what have you really done? An analyst criticising Jaguar building their very first EV. Sometimes you just want to know that someone's done it. If someone is an analyst, you want to know that they've worked for a car maker, that they've done something like build their first EV. They've got the experience to know what they're talking about. You don't want someone who's fresh out of business school. They've got their MBA and now they've got their job as the big analyst. And they have a criticism against a car maker like Jaguar because they don't like the infotainment system. But this analyst says that their clients investing shouldn't be impressed by it. However, he's also driven the Audi EV, the e-tron, and Mr. Osher says that the latter is much more worrying for someone like Tesla. He says this, and I quote, "The I-Pace we drove was elegantly appointed. It had the excellent fit and finish that Jaguars usually do, and Teslas sometimes do not. The interior and controls are laid out in the traditional configuration, which may be attractive to some buyers not ready to embrace Tesla's display-based user interface," end quote. The listed range, by the way, is 234 miles, which is obviously less than the Model 3, which has a very efficient battery. As you regular listeners may know of the podcast, I have 5 days left in my 20-year radio career, which is coming to an end, and I'm going to try and give podcasts a go full-time, but if it doesn't work out, maybe I could be a podcast analyst and just talk about things that I don't know about. Let's finish off with a classic Mini. A Mini that's got a full electric conversion. The fashion for producing EVs powered by classic cars shows no sign of slowing down, with Swind, S-W-I-N-D, Swind, revealing its zero emissions take on the original Mini. Yes, this is the one that you would have seen in the original Italian job. You're only supposed to blow the bloody doors off. Replacing its combustion drivetrain with a modern electric one. It follows hot on the heels of Jaguar's Land Rover Classics converted, the E-Types, the Aston Martin DB6 Volant getting transferred to electric power, says Sam Jenkins for Evo magazine. Due to the nature of electric motors, torque is available immediately. And even though the Mini is a tiny lightweight car, it only manages 0-62 in 9.2 seconds, still quicker than the 50s original though. Power comes in at 80 kilowatts, equivalent to about 110 brake horsepower. It'll hit a top speed of 80 miles an hour. Range is usually an issue for electric cars, says Evo, showing some wonderful ignorance. The E-Classic Mini has a range of 125, which they say is respectable. Thank you very much for your thoughts, but I'll put a link to the Evo magazine in the show notes if you want to read more. Finally, you've got a couple of days left to get your answers in for question of the week. I'd love to hear from you. Thanks to myev.com, they've sent us this question. Are you part of an EV club or association, online or physically? Do you think there's more reason for electric car owners to be part of a community? Maybe on Facebook you've joined some sort of owners club or interest group. Let me know, or a forum. Let me know your story. You can email me personally, hello@evnewsdaily.com. That is hello@evnewsdaily.com. Or leave a comment on YouTube and Facebook and myev.com. There are 183 patrons of this podcast. It's how it gets made, how I'm able to quit my job and try some new adventures. Give me the bravery to do that. Know the bills are going to be paid and all those kind of things. So you can check that out. Patreon.com/EVNewsDaily. PATREON.com. And, you know, I'll make this show whatever. What would mean more to me, actually, is if you could leave a little review somewhere. One star, five stars, say some words. That would be very much appreciated. There are 388 episodes of this show online for free. You can subscribe to new ones. Hit that subscribe button to get them for first and free and automatically. I am looking into sorting out the Alexa skill, by the way, because Alexa skills only like to play audio less than 10 minutes. And as you can see, I've been waffling on for 20 now, and it sort of broke my Alexa skill that I built. So I need to do a shorter version, maybe a secondary podcast, maybe a headline show that's 60 seconds that you can play on your Alexa. I'll add it to the list of things that I've got to do. Come and say hi on the socials by searching EV News Daily. Have a wonderful day. I'll catch you tomorrow. And remember, there's no such thing as a self-charging hybrid.